going to be chairing the meeting. My name is Lorna. I'm a member of the SWP and also the Bakers Union, and I'm an activist in the fast food rights campaign as well. I'm a fast food worker myself on a zero hours contract and also on minimum wage. And everybody knows what zero hours contracts are. In theory, they're supposed to be flexible for workers. You're not obliged to work any hours that the employer gives you, but in reality, it's obviously quite different. If you don't work the hours they give you, then you know your hours are affected the following weeks. There's absolutely no consistency or security with your work. I'm also on minimum wage, and minimum wage is really nothing. You can't pay your bills, you can't make your rent. And I just really want to emphasise as well, actually, that these conditions, zero hours contracts and minimum wage, they actually do have a direct effect on your living standards, and they can seep into every aspect of your life and affect some of the most basic human needs and rights, which is a total disgrace in the 21st century. This is the grim reality for a lot of working people. It was last November. I just wanted to give one example, actually, of one of the staff members who we recently signed up to the union. She has even less job security than me. She's not even on the payroll, and she actually has 2 zero-hour contract jobs to just try and make ends meet. When she lost her previous zero-hour contract job, she was nearly made homeless because she couldn't pay her bills. And actually, because she isn't on the payroll, she has the least amount of security. Our boss, he basically victimises her, and she works the least amount of hours out of everyone. She works 2-hour shifts, sometimes 3 days in a row, which is at minimum wage after tax, less than a tenner for a whole day's wage. So not feeling like that she was in a position, obviously, to not do these hours, she needs the money, you end up feeling totally demoralised and you feel totally disrespected. But yeah, I'm really pleased to say that we actually signed her up to the union last week. So, And I guess this all started as well last November when I went to a fast food rights public meeting that we had in Glasgow, and some of the workers from the States came over and they shared their totally inspiring story. And it was that day that I joined, and I remember going back to my workplace and talking to my workmates. I signed up one of my pals, and since then, just a few months on, we've now achieved 100% membership in our workplace. And that is, these kinds of workplaces, they are, especially fast food outlets, they're hugely isolating, really demoralising. You can feel powerless, like the weight of the world's on your shoulder, when it's just you up against these multinational corporate businesses. That's why I really want to stress the importance of organising in your workplace, because the way that everyone in my workplace feels is now just totally empowered, and like we're actually able to make real demands and real gains in our workplace. So that's why I'm really excited about tonight's meeting, because we have a really fantastic panel of speakers who are going to share their experiences with us and ideas. And I'm really excited to introduce our first speakers, who've been leading one of the most inspiring struggles. They've been on an all-out indefinite strike for the past 16 weeks. It's Christine and Mary from the Glasgow Homeless Caseworkers Strike. So,
hi there. I've come down from Glasgow today with my colleague, Mary. We are caseworkers and we work with the homeless people in Glasgow. We've been out on strike for 16 weeks. We're looking for a regrade of our job, and all we're looking for is to be on the same level as other social care workers who are doing a similar job. Over the last 16 weeks, I think we've only had 2 offers and both were rejected. There's 72 caseworkers, there's 70 of us out on strike, and we're looking all to go back on the same grade. What has happened is they initially, after 4 weeks, met with the unions and told us to go back to work and they would look at service reform. However, a lot of our workers had already been through that and said it was redundancies and sidesteps and jobs that they didn't apply for. So that was rejected. They then come back about 4 weeks later and offered 52 posts, but there's 70 of us. They then come back, I think, another 4 weeks later and offered 64 posts. But at this point in time, they then said our team leaders, who are the grade above us, would also slot into those posts. Now, there's 13 team leaders and six of them may well have been promoted. However, the other seven would have taken the seven of those posts, which, again, just reduced the figures. We have rejected that. We're not going back. We're going back as a team. And we're not accepting anything other than everyone getting the same grade. I'm trying to think what else is happening here. We have had a lot of support from all the trade unions around Britain, really. I have been down in London the last three weekends talking at various different conferences and things like that, and the support we've received has been amazing. The one thing that has kind of kept us going back up in Scotland, we had the porters from the Ninewell Hospital in Dundee, and they were out for 13 weeks and they won everything they went for. That has given us a bit of hope. We kind of know that there's a meeting again on Monday chief executive of Glasgow City Council and the corporate HR. We're hoping they're going to come up with something that's going to be acceptable or something that at least we can debate on, because what they've given us so far has been rubbish. That's basically where we are just now. We're standing strong. The picket lines are strong. 16 weeks down the line, I think everybody's still saying we've been out this length of time, we're not going back. It really has brought us all together in a way that we weren't before. So that's where we are now. Okay. Can I just say that we would like any other trade unions to get in touch with us. We're going to hand out some papers. If you could give us phone numbers, if you want to come and support us or ask for us to come down and talk at any of your conferences. Okay. Sorry, I'm being asked to say something and I've forgotten what it was I was to say. I'm sure we'll get it to you later on. Okay, thanks very much. Oh, yeah. There is, I think, going to be a collection as you leave tonight, so we would be very grateful if anyone could donate anything to our strike fund. Okay, thanks very much.
Thanks so much. I forgot to actually mention as well that we're going to hear from Janelle Ware very soon, who is a fast food worker from the US, and they've obviously been leading a totally inspiring strike in the States, and part of, he's a McDonald's worker and part of the fight for 15. So we're going to hear from Janelle in just a minute. Can we clap for them just to welcome them? To them?
I'm going first. I just wanted to speak to you tonight. I work for Greggs and I work in a shop for Greggs. And I just wanted to share some success stories, because the idea is that people that work in shops are difficult to organise. And I am part of the biggest branch of Greggs. And we can organise. It's not easy. I'm not saying that it's easy. It's taken a lot of hard work, a lot of consistency, and a lot of persistence with some members. But you can get it done. We're a bakery-based retail business, and all the branches are based around the bakery, and then they all have 200 shops. So my branch has got 1,000 members with the 200 shops and the bakeries, which is quite a good feat for people that can not be organised. So I don't want to go on too much, because I know that the people from Skype are waiting, and Ian can cover things a lot better than I can. But just persistence, consistency, and just talk to people. Whenever we're in a shop, whether I'm there to represent somebody or whether I'm just nipping in for my lunch or my break or whatever, I just talk to people about the benefits of joining a union. We don't have 0 hours contracts in Greggs. We are paid higher than the minimum wage, And the minimum contract, we have part-time people, and we also give people the opportunity to just come and work for us on a Saturday if they want, and there's always the opportunity for overtime. And if Greggs can do it at a £1 billion company, why can't McDonald's do it at a multi-billion pound company?
Cheers, Sarah. I mean, let's be clear. I mean, not only is the organised, unorganised, not only are they the biggest branch within Greggs, they're the biggest branch within the Bakers Union. In Sarah's branch alone, there's 1,000 members. I mean, that's a phenomenal success for an area which is so difficult to organise. And it just proves, like Sarah says, persistence and consistency will enable you to recruit in areas which sometimes seem so difficult, which the fast food industry is often seen as being so difficult that most trade unions that have attempted it have often decided that it was too difficult and walked away, which has enabled companies like McDonald's to pioneer 0-hours contracts and low wage and inequality that's now seen in every workplace across our country. And it's a tragedy, really. It's a tragedy that the unions that had the opportunity to begin to organise didn't decide that it was the right thing to do. But we believe it is the right thing to do now. And I just want to cover a couple of areas because the campaign is moving on. The campaign is moving on. We've seen some successes in recruiting members. But we believe that the next part of this campaign is to take this campaign on. Obviously, we've been doing regular campaigns outside. We occupy and we take our campaign into the communities. But we believe now there's a need to actually move this campaign to a new level. And that level includes bringing all sorts of different organisations into this campaign, other trade unions into this campaign, you know, the Black Lives Matter campaign, the Homeless People's campaign, every single campaign that you can think of, because our society now is faced with an absolute tragedy. It's faced with an absolute appalling situation where the norm in this country is going to be 0 hours and low pay. So we believe now that the Hungry for Justice campaign needs to step up and make sure that we change our communities and our society. And we believe that the first stages of doing that are by organising through the communities, bringing everybody in and explaining to them why it's important that community organisations and trade unions work together. It's a critical now, if we want to change our society and give a future for our young people, that we organise and explain the need to work and support one another. Because if we don't, what we've seen over the last 30 years will continue for the next generation too. So it's important now that we get that message to any organisation that you work with, any trade union that you're in, to say, on the 16th of September, there's going to be a meeting at TUC Congress, and we want you to get people in that room because we want to start in this country a fight back from the grassroots, from the bottom up. And that is the way we believe that it'll enable us to change our communities and society. We believe it's about time in this country we move to a situation where Britain put up a fight against all of the inequality by starting up its own civil rights movement. And we believe the fast food rights campaign and the Hungry for Justice campaign is the model to be able to enable us to do that. So we want you, we want everybody in this room to take that message to your trade union, to take that message to any community organisation that you're working with, to say no longer we're prepared to accept injustice, inequality, unfairness, low pay, 0 hours. No longer are we going to allow those people who feel that we have to accept what's going on in our society without a fight back. No longer are we prepared to say it's acceptable to sack people like Candy Unwin or Jenny and Damien from the UCU or the Fire Brigade Union. No longer is acceptable to say when they bring in legislation to restrict trade unions from taking legal action, when they say it's no longer reasonable for us to be able to politically campaign and the TUC sit on the backsides and do nothing. No longer is that acceptable. And if we allow that to become the norm, the trade union movement will die, your communities will fester. And I'll tell you this now, the only way to change that is by coming along, joining with your community groups, joining with trade unions and fighting back and demanding that the TUC. I mean, I went to the Defend the Unions thing the other week and I said, you know, Frances O'Grady is celebrated for being the first woman. Wouldn't it be great to celebrate Frances O'Grady, not because of her gender, because she turned around and she said, we're not going to take any more attacks on the trade union movement. We're not going to allow our activists to be dismissed. And we're not going to take any new legislation, because I'll tell you what, we'll see you on the streets, we'll take direct action, we'll occupy, and I'll tell you the last thing that we're going to do as well, we're going to call a general strike, because that's what we need to do. Let's take our society back, let's get all of our communities, time for a fight back, join us.
Thanks so much. So yeah, I'm really, really pleased to give a really warm welcome to Jarell. We'll just pass it over straight to Jarell. He's going to appear. Really warm welcome.
Hello, USA!
Okay, you're on.
Are you on now?
Yes!
That was such an embarrassing moment. it's a pleasure talking to you guys. My name is Jerome Ware, and I work for McDonald's. It's actually the number one store in the world. Well, you know, my pay's not number one. So it really doesn't matter, right? Basically, I've been part of this campaign since 2013, and I've been on 8 strikes, 34 years old. Strike was such a bad word back in the day. You know, strike, you're crazy. You know, you have to fight for something, you know. These guys do, companies have to get over on us for centuries, decades. You know, it's not centuries. They got it, essentially. But decades, they get over on us, and, you know, they get over on the whole country. You know, because, you know, they're making billions of dollars, they're not paying the livable wages, and as a result, you know, me and other fast food people and other people around the country have to get on public assistance. And, you know, it's not fair. We work full-time hours and we work for a billion-dollar company. It makes no sense. Basically, like I said, I'm 34. I live in the Bronx, New York, you know. You know, I have to sometimes, you know, I make $200 a week, and sometimes I decide whether or not I'm going to eat, or I'm not going to, you know, pay for the metro car to get to work. You know, and it's not enough to make it. Like, I cannot make it. And it's sad because sometimes on payday, like today I got paid on my check, I'm in no rush. You know, because it's not mine, you know. It's not fair. It's not fair that I work $40 a week and I have to live in poverty and I work for a company that doesn't care. It's not fair. My CEO of McDonald's, he makes $10,000 an hour. Let me get that here. It came up to a point in time where I got tired. You know, and now I'm part of this movement. You know, I've been on H strike, like I said, I took a rest. You know, because, you know, we got to stand, but sometimes you got to go to desperate measures so people can't understand you and hear you. And, you know, we started with 200 workers in New York City, and now we're in 240 cities and we're global. And home care workers are in the problem. You know, it's a wonderful thing when I see how it's trickling around the world. I remember we were just known about in New York City. Now, you know, I travel to different states and people are like, I see you on TV, I see you on Facebook, oh wow, everything's good. Like, you know, the world is getting around. It's amazing how if you stand for something, you know, and you come together as one, you're powerful. You're more powerful than governments, presidents, and all that. If you just stick together, and it's all about sticking together and being fed up. And, you know, we individuals, human beings, we want to get treated equally. It doesn't matter if you make a whole lot of money or you make a little bit of money, you still want to get treated equally. I'm not saying, well, it'd be nice if I could make $10,000. But, you know, I'm not asking for that. I'm wishing that, but I'm not asking for that. But, you know, if you're making $10,000 and I work for you and I'm making you these billions of dollars, to be correct, $10 million a year profit McDonald's makes. Like, it's ridiculous, you know, these fast food restaurants, and I guess, you know governments and mayors and, you know, the whole around the country and around the world, they're going to see that, you know, that the public assistance and the state, and they have to take care of the workers that is working for a billion-dollar company. You know, these billion-dollar companies have to start taking responsibility for their workers. You know, instead of just buying extra boats and houses and cars and, you know, my owner McDonald's, when I went to 56th Street. She came in, I talked to her, I said, no one could set the bar for to have a little wage. And, you know, she said she couldn't, and she stepped out into a limousine. On to our next door. You know, these people, you know, they've been making a mockery of us for a long time. It's time for us to stop letting these bad food companies in our way. I mean, you know, it's just been a wonderful experience the past few years, and, you know, a lot of states, you know, from the fight to 15, a lot of states in the United States have made it minimum wage $15, just from the fight to 15, and, you know, like I said, it's time for, you know, there's nobody, and I mean nobody, that works 40 hours a week should be living in poverty, and that's just the fact. After a while, you know, when people see you doing the right thing, you know, just like, for instance, our governor of New York City, he convened a three-board member wage board for fast food workers, which was so nice of him because, you know, he finally seen, like, you know what, he agreed, like, you know, we're just not making it in these fast food restaurants. And, you know, a lot of people, you know, when they get upset, you know, say, other industries say, you know what, why fast food workers? Because, you know, as fast food workers, you know, we got looked at like the bomber's nice shoe, the bomb of the battle. Even customers look at us like, oh, you know, that's a restaurant, oh, you visible maze worker, oh, you know. But, you know, I set the mark, and a lot of my fast food workers set the mark. Yeah, we're people too. And you know what? We set the mark. And we were the ones to have enough courage to start this movement. You know, other industries didn't do that. You know, they should have knocked us for, you know, stand up for what we believe in, and they should have stood up for what we believe in too. But this is not only a fast food thing. This is for every worker that's not made a minimum wage, and it's time for it to stop now. And, you know, he convened board members to talk this over. And, you know, we had four wage hearings throughout the state of New York. And, you know, he heard the wage board, heard a lot of testimonies. They heard even from people that was against the fight for 15. Who say, well, we don't need, you know, a livable wage. You know, $8.75 is enough to live in New York City, which, you know, $1,100 for one bedroom was in New York City. There's no way in the world $8.75 is going to make it. You know, especially all the other things. Food is more expensive. It's like everything is going up instead of our pay. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, food will go up, the cost of living will go up, tremendous dollars. But when it's time for a raise, we get 10 cents. 25 cents, you know, stuff like this. It just doesn't happen, you know? So we here make it happen. And the wage board is here for us to determine, you know, whether or not we need a higher wage. And, you know, it's determined. You know, it just goes to show you that, you know, when we stand together, we're gonna win. To have a little weight. We work 40 hours a week. They heard a lot of testimonies. They heard from economists. They heard from, like I said, people that was against the fight for 15. And, you know, like I said, you know, they sat back, and you could tell, like, when they were talking to people against fight for 15, they were still adamant about asking specific questions. You know, they couldn't really answer. They kept on, the people that was against the fight for 15 kept on going around the answer, because there's no logical answer. And there's nothing you could just think up. You know what I'm saying? And they know that. You know, and I'm just happy to see, you know, like I said, you know, I remember when this movement was just only in New York City, and now I look around and look and talk to you guys. And it's a wonderful experience, you know? What country are you guys in?
Yeah. All right.
Yeah.
UK.
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah. We're in London, England.
I'm not shy, but I'm like kind of nervous. But yes, like I said, you know, it's a big movement. I love the support from you guys, and I just thank you for the opportunity, you know, to see how much growth this movement has become, and how many people are affected by this movement, and how many people are willing to do something about their situation. And that, I thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Sherelle. That was amazing. And and thank you as well for the inspiring struggle. I actually have a message as well. There's a choir that are here tonight that have learned one of the songs from your picket lines in America, and we're going to sing it at the end of the meeting in solidarity, so stick around for that. Moving on to our next speakers. Yes, we've got some speakers from the Sotheby's. Really pleased to introduce Barbara and Percy.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's such a great pleasure to be here tonight. We are members from United Voices of the World. We work for Sotheby's, for a company called Service. On the 30th of June, we participated in a lawful protest demanding our contractual sick pay and the London living wages backdated. So on the next day when we went to work, we've been removed from site. It was simply fact because we participated in a protest. So we are here to ask you for solidarity with the cleaners and porters for Sotheby's. Four of us, we've been removed from site. Please follow us. Please write to Sotheby's, you know, because we want our job back. And we are more... I'm sure things is going to work out for us with your support, with your help. And such a big thanks for Candy and here, Sandy, and obviously for our union representative, Petros, who did such a great job. And please follow us in uvwunion.org.uk. And also please sign our petition in change.org. And also we got protests organized for this Friday 16. So we're all going to meet at 6 p.m. in Oxford Circus, and we're all going to march to Sotheby's. Thank you so much. I pass to Percy.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Percy. I'm one of the Sotheby's four that we are asking Sotheby's to get our job back. And of course, with the support of all of you guys, you know, there was some massive support from people that even I don't know them. But, you know, I think we didn't demand any crazy thing. It's just a contractual sick pay, because at the moment we just receive £88 a week that nobody could survive with £320 a month, you know. And the living... the London living wage backdated. You know, we are talking about Sotheby's, one of the auction house biggest in the world. You know, and last Wednesday, on the first of Wednesday, in the contemporary auction, they sold more than £130 million. So, what we are asking is, I think, is a very fair request to them. And so, please, with the support of all of you guys, next Wednesday or next Thursday at 6 o'clock, we're meeting at Oxford Circus. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thanks very much. So on to our final speaker, which is Sandy from the SOAS Union. He's part of a union branch that, where migrant cleaners have led strikes that have won some really serious victories. So over to Sandy.
It's actually a real privilege to be on a platform with the Bakers Union and work that they've done with the comrades from the US and the fast food workers' rights movement there, which is truly inspirational. But also to be standing next to Barbara and Percy from the UVW, a group of workers, migrant workers, like the cleaners in my branch, that have actually stood up and said they're not going to be treated like second-class citizens in this country. They're actually demanding their rights, and they're demanding that they're treated as workers in a fair and reasonable manner. And the fact that a company like Sotheby's has got the cheek to try and sack them for that is, I think, something an affront to every trade unionist anywhere in this country, and we should all unite and get behind them and give them the maximum support that we can. I'm also quite privileged to be the branch secretary of Unison at SOAS. Privileged for a very simple reason, that I have the SOAS cleaners in my branch, a group of migrant cleaning workers that have fought over the last 9 years And I've actually turned their outsourcing contract, which was the minimum that people have talked about, you know, the minimum wage, no sick pay, no, you know, basic, you know, statutory minimum holidays and whatever, and they've fought every inch of the way. So they now have, you know, they won the living wage in 2008. They won union recognition. We've now got a steward structure that the rest of my union branch would be proud of, you know, four or five stewards trained and organised to actually lead that workforce. They've actually won in the last year 7 extra days annual leave on their contracts. They won the increase to 6 months of full pay for when they're off sick. Some of you think about it, you know, directly employed workers in my university take for granted, but for those workers it's fantastically important because it means that actually if they're ill, they don't face being evicted from their homes because they can't pay the rent. They don't face having to come into work as cleaners, you know, in a really, really quite dangerous environment if you think about it, and actually sacrifice their health in order to be able to feed themselves. They've won 6 months of full pay. That's a fantastic achievement, and they even forced the employer to quadruple the contribution to their pension scheme. How did they do it? Because like the colleague there says, they're 100% organised in the trade union. And why it was important that they did that is actually they've been able to demand and get the support from our branch, and that's how they've led to those victories. And I think it's important to start from that point, because what it shows is that there's this nonsense that's peddled that these workers can't be organised, and it is a nonsense. When they get the support from their trade unions, when they get the backing from the movement in this country, they can deliver, you know? And it's actually a bit of a scandal, isn't it? That they're fighting for a $15 wage in the US, and they've won it in city after city where they've campaigned. In the UK, where our movement is meant to be significantly stronger than it is in the US, we haven't even begun to achieve some of the things that they've achieved. And that's what I think I wanted to say today, is that actually the most important thing for us is we need to be putting pressure on the mainstream trade unions to start to deliver for the workers like we've seen today. People that are prepared to stand up and fight, you know, quite fantastic heroic people, to be honest. I mean, some of the people I've met campaigning in this area have actually inspired me enormously, because they are incredibly strong. You know, they are incredibly, you know, when they get organised, they're actually prepared to make that stand against the employer, but they need that support. And we should be putting pressure on the mainstream unions to deliver it. And that's the biggest gap, I think, here. It's not their willingness to fight. They've shown that time and time again. It's whether or not we're prepared to back them and give them the support that they need. And if they can do it in the US, where the unions faced an existentialist crisis, you know, a few years ago, and they've actually started to bring hope back into the trade union movement by the work that they've done around the fast food workers and others and the organising they've done, then we can do the same in this country. And actually, I think we've got a labour movement that needs to turn around and needs to start taking this issue seriously. It's fantastic what the bakers have done, but the bakers shouldn't be alone. Every union in this country that's actually organisers in these sectors needs to get behind these workers. The last thing I was going to talk about is a bit about how do we do it, because I think the discussion needs to move on to what we need to do. So the first thing is actually to put pressure on our own unions to start delivering in these areas. The second thing is actually to look at how the US workers have achieved what they've achieved. And that's actually largely through a combination of straightforward organising and side unions, along with actually addressing the issues of communities. You know, Ian talked about, you know, we need to get in the communities. We were able to use the fact that almost all our cleaners are Latin American migrants and actually go and talk to those communities, engage those communities and get them involved. And that could give a huge amount of support to our campaign. But we need to look at, I live in a city called London. I go home every night on the bus, and every night on the bus I hear young Spanish people talking, right? They're here as economic migrants into the UK. What were they involved in when they were 17, 18? The squares movements in Spain. Some of them will be individual members of Podemos. A lot of them will be people that have actually been engaged in political activity. We need to engage with those communities. Young Greek kids, you know, there's a couple that live in my street. They're members of Syriza. We need to be engaging those people and saying, actually, it's important what you do here as well, and actually building trade union organising and getting organised is something we can all do. But if we pool those resources, if we mobilise the campaigns, if we get involved with, you know, essentially putting pressure on these companies, they can buckle and we can break them. You know, a lot of them, actually, their reputation is really important to them. And if we can actually start tarring them with being the low-paid, skinflint cheapskates that they actually are, right, and actually putting pressure on them, then I think we can break them and we can actually win real gains in this. And I say, my cleaners have proven it, you know, through their own struggle, their own organising ability, their own ability to fight. What they needed was the backing of the rest of the trade union movement. And my branch, they got that, right? I think we should make sure that's the case across the country. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much to all our speakers. We're just going to open up to the floor now for discussion. So if you want to make a contribution, just raise your hand.
Hello. Well, I'm from Hotel Branch in Unite. Yeah. And I really regret not joining the union before and not being a rep before, because you see the difference, you know, you make, you know. At the beginning, we have plenty of excuses not to join the union, because you come to London, you don't know how long you're going to stay in the city, you don't know how long you're going to work in that hotel or in that sector, and you are not British, so you think, okay, somebody else who will do something and improve the working conditions, you know, and the pay in the sector. But the sooner we start, it's the better. The sooner we start, the better will be the conditions. And, we are not recognized, for instance, in the hotel I'm working, but after doing a course to be a rep, I am helping other trade unions from Unite in other hotels, you know, and you can see the difference, because as soon as they say the management that they're being accompanied by somebody from Unite, they are treated better and more politely, and they are taking it more seriously. So they are scared of the brand damage we can make to them, you know. So in any disciplinary or even in any grievance meeting. And then when I talk to the colleagues in the workplace at the result of what's going on in the other hotels, they get more confident, and they might join the union in the hotel. So little by little, we are getting that confidence we need, you know. So, for instance, we in Unite, we are working with HIT teams, which is Hotel Employee Action Teams. And if you are not recognized in your hotel, in your workplace, you meet with people from the same company, from the same brand, from the same chain, and you share the results, the ideas, and you get more confident as well. So we do all that, you know. And then when we went to the elections we were doing in the Millennium, which is the company serving the Eurostar, and we realized that they can have elections for reps and for health and safety and for shop steward, and for they are having a room for meeting, and they don't have to meet outside the workplace, and you see the difference having a recognized union. You know, having a union recognized in your workplace has. So I think everybody, you know, can make a difference. The customers or the consumers can make a difference as well. When somebody complains that something about the hotel always reacts. So if they complain that they are short of staff, the company is going to react. So everything can make a difference. Not only the trade unions, of course, the trade unions can help with activists and with some resources, but we really think that all of you can help as well. Not only with campaigns and not only with, you know, with what you are doing now. We can have to increase a little bit the pressure on those big companies. For instance, is the fourth industry in Britain, the hotel industry. They are charged £145 per room. So you can imagine, and there are more than 136,000 rooms in London. So you can imagine the money they can pay to improve their working conditions. And another problem that the industry is suffering is that the high staff turnover. People get in, they are trained, and before 1 year or after some months, they leave. So they don't have skilled workers, so they are silly. And then they have to organize open day to explain the kind of job they are going to do in the hotel. So I think they are really, really stupid thinking of, if they think of profitability and benefits, they should think of the workforce as well, okay?
I just wanted to say 3 points. First one was just very quickly about perspective. What everyone said before about the way that work is intensified, they always tried to make you do more. The bullying, the manager at my workplace swears at everyone, particularly me, all the time, every day. Just does it, gets away. They can fire people on the spot. Self-employed contracts, zero-hour contracts, that's all true. And it's certainly true that young workers, there's certainly fear in terms of unionising and trying to fight back. But also, it's not just fear. There's also a lot of anger. And young workers are very political. Not many people in my workplace like the Tories, for example. They don't like the rich. But if they don't see they can change anything, then they go back to their lives. And for some people, the kind of wages we get seems like a novelty. I think when people start... My branch in Norwich, they feel that when people reach their 30s and realise the wages and conditions aren't good enough to actually have a better job, and etc., that's when millions of young workers who are in these conditions are going to start to fight big time, whether the unions do it or not. That's perspective number one. But number two, resistance. What do we do about it? Because in call centres, in places like Aviva, Financial, these are big places. In Norwich, Aviva employs 2,000 workers. Call centres in Norwich employ about 1,500 workers. So these are quite big workplaces. They use computerised systems to monitor how many people you talk to. They have a conveyor belt over how many people you talk to. It sounds like Orwellianly horrible, etc. But actually, there's a lot of resistance. I'll give an example. Our manager went away for a holiday, which was brilliant, because we took over the workplace, and the mini managers tried to put the squeeze on everyone. And at lunchtime, because we've been trying to meet up at lunch to build a union, and we've got to that habit, my workmates stormed out of work and said, we've got to do something about it. So we went to lunch, and I said, look, when you deliberately go slow, it's called a dialer, it's like a conveyor belt, it slows the conveyor belt down, and it grinds it down, and it causes real problems. The management panic. We did that. It slowed the day down. The mini managers panicked, started phoning the engineers. Engineers panicked. It completely destroyed the day's work. And the management then came back and said, we have to slow down. We have to back off. So there's resistance like that. There's resistance like humour. People, it's actually quite hard to get workers to work. But it's very hard to get... I found it very hard without the backing of the union to get workers to join a union. We've had like 6 out of work meetings. It's really hard to get people to join unions. And it's also tied to organised workers. When organised workers take action, it gives us confidence. I've looked at when things have been really good at work and we've been fighting and been able to do a few things. And that's when it's given confidence to do stuff. And when we don't fight, it's really bad. And the union needs to take it seriously. We organised an out of work meeting, and I asked the Unite organising official to come down. And he came down and he did this speech about how difficult it was going to be, how a big challenge, and was telling all of us, the management are going to throw everything at you. And it destroyed our confidence, even destroyed my confidence. And I want unions like the Bakers Union, not like Unite, where I am, where they come down and tell you. Lastly, something up. What can you do about it? I think you have to be more than just a trade unionist. You have to be a tribune of the oppressed. You have to take up issues around sexism, racism, homophobia, and also using petitions. I've got some props here. This is a petition over our wage slips being given out on time. We did it last week, and 22 out of a workplace of 30 signed, and we're going to hand it in to the manager, all of us, not one, because that's stupid, and we want our wage slips on time. So this is something everyone can do, and it's a way of building the union and saying you could win something, because you have to start from somewhere if there's no one in a union when you join a workplace. And this is what you do, and this is another one on Greece and solidarity, and 10 people signed. So the key points is people do resist. The unions need to take it seriously. We need a fight. It affects unorganised workers, what organised workers do, and things like petitions, taking up small issues to win some momentum is really important to build up, and that things could start to kick off if we start to do all those things. But the unions need to take it seriously.
Hello, my name is Petros, and I'm the trade union rep of Percy and Barbara over there at Sotheby's from UVW Union. I just wanted to say a few words about my experiences, which may help in any debates we have later, may contribute to that. I've been organising in the Latin American community for the last 4 years, and I've been involved in several campaigns for living wages, and principally for dignity and respect, because most of our members are in the cleaning sector. and the outsource sector generally. So we have security and some other workers. And dignity and respect is the principal thing which we normally campaign for, because the levels of abuse are just ridiculous. And these companies think, they don't have reputations to protect outsourcing companies, which is an interesting dynamic in a campaign, because you can't name and shame them because they just don't give a crap. So we have to target the clients where our members work, and we're very much now completely sidestepping the outsourcing companies in our campaigns, and we're going straight to the client. And this is a far more effective thing to do. Before, we were very much trying to deal with the outsourcing company, ask them to negotiate with us, sit down and talk to them. And now we're just hitting the client, which is interesting in terms of tactics. But just, I really wanted to say that, in what I've been doing, I've been inspired every day by our members. We haven't recruited anybody. All our members have come through word of mouth. Interestingly, no one actually comes looking to campaign. So when they join our union, they normally come with an individual grievance. They weren't paid, they were underpaid, they were abused, sexually abused, physically assaulted, everything, victimized, whatever it may be, discriminated against. And as a union, we're trying to turn all of those grievances into campaigns, because obviously, if you're just addressing the individual grievances, you're going to be doing that for 1,000 years. So as soon as we do get a grievance, we essentially try and turn it into a collective grievance, then we turn that into a campaign. And we've been very successful. And, just last month we launched a living wage campaign at Withers Law Firm. It's a multinational law firm. And we won, and it took us 2 weeks. So we wrote to... They were all on the minimum wage. We wrote to the law company. We set up a protest on Facebook. We said we'd be outside their offices every single week. We had about 100 people confirmed on Facebook. We were about to write to all their clients and tell them how miserly they were. 2 days before the protest, I said, "You've got it, living wage, done." Yay. Yeah. And then we realised we had them on the back foot, so we asked them to backdate it to the 1st of November, and they did that as well. And just very briefly on the issue of Sotheby's, as Sandy was saying, it is an absolute disgrace. Sotheby's has not even tried to think of another they normally dress it up, they victimize people and they say they're not working well, or they've got conduct issues, performance issues. They've actually openly said, "You protested and therefore you're fired." So, and Sandy said, it is an absolute disgrace, and it does make everyone vulnerable, because if Sotheby's gets away with it, other companies will see that and use that to inspire them to continue victimizing workers. So we have launched a huge campaign at Sotheby's, which we've actually been involved in for 6 months. We won the living wage there last year. Sotheby's was cutting their hourly wage, actually cutting it. They were going down. They went from 8.80 to 8.55, 8.30. So that was before they joined the union. They obviously had to save costs. That was the reason. the multi-billion pound auction house. They joined the union. We won the living wage. We got that quickly. We then won contractual sick pay. And that's something that we're actually fighting for now as a union a lot, because statutory sick pay is an absolute disgrace, as you all know, because it's only £88 a week. So, all of these companies, beyond living wages, we need contractual sick pay. And that's what we're fighting for at Sotheby's. And once we've got the reinstated, which we will do, we'll be going back for our contractual sick pay.
Hello, everybody. My name is Tony. I'm a Bakers Union member and also a member of the SWP. Jurel, you went away briefly, and I'm happy that you're back, because I just wanted to thank you so much for your contribution. The T-shirt kind of gives it away, but I'm part of the choir that Lorna was talking about, and we've been singing McDonald's, McDonald's a lot, and it's really sort of connected me to your struggle, which has just been brilliant, so thank you very much. So I just want to briefly share with you some of my experiences as a zero-hour minimum wage contracted worker, why I joined a union, I'm part of the Bakers Union, and why I feel it's so important to organise workers. So I need to work two jobs to make ends meet, and I can't rely on one job to give me the hours that I need, so I need to work two jobs. But because of the precarious nature of zero-hour contracts, I could be working 5 hours one week and 50 hours the next. I mean, how can you factor your life around it? It's completely impossible. But I need to take all the hours I can get, because of in one job I get paid minimum wage, the other I get living wage, which is a step in the right direction on my boss's part. But it's still not enough. It's just the wage is just too low. So sorry. the environment that these sort of jobs foster is one of disrespect and the feeling of being completely disposable. If I don't act the way my boss wants me to, silly reasons such as if I put on music that we'd like to listen to apart from instead of the chart music that the radio station's the horrible, terrible music that he puts on, he will remind me in a sneaky way of my disposability and therefore create a climate of fear in the workplace, the kind of environment that no workers should be subjected to. So I don't want to go into too much detail about the conditions under which I work, but facing issues such as sexism, cronyism, poor health and safety, no job security, and zero respect in the workplace. Facing these from day one, working in these kinds of places have all led me to reach out for help, and I have found this within the Bakers Union. So less than 10% of young people are members of a trade union, and only 3.5% of food service employees are in a union. So these are the kinds of people who are subject to bullying in the workplace, who are most likely to feel demoralized and isolated. And it's imperative that we reach out to these people to get them signed up to the union and work together to change these working conditions. So we've recently been signing people up in our own workplace. And as Lorna said, we've actually just signed up the last member last week. So now we're at 100% union membership, which is wonderful. So finally, another thing that low-paid, zero-hours contract workplaces are great at doing are zapping people's energy and self-worth. And we have so we've recently started working on a project to fight this and to harness our collective creativity. So we're going to make a short film about the very conditions under which we work. And we formally invite all of you to take part. I think, Chris, are you handing out? So Chris will be at the back. Thank you very much for having me. Thank you.
Hi there. Helen Davis, Barnett Unison. I think that people associate my branch as being, you know, well, what have you got to say? Because you're not organising the unorganised, they are the organised. But actually, I think most workplaces, the reality is, most workplaces have huge areas in them which are unorganised. So even in public sector is supposed to be the place where everybody's organised, but the reality is, trying to get strikes off the ground, trying to maintain those strikes is quite an ordeal because there aren't the reps. And actually, one of the areas where we struggle with organisation is children's social work. Why? Because the colleagues are working nose to the grindstone, you know, up to 12 hours a day. It's not different. The difference is, the reason why they're doing that is not fear of losing their job, but it's fear a child will die on their books if they don't do that, and then the fear of the vilification, the punishment, etc., etc., that goes in the press. So I do think that one of the issues, colleague that spoke earlier talked about the importance of being political in the workplace, and that is important. It is important that we defend workers when they're under that much pressure and when they make mistakes, because sometimes the plate will drop off of that spinning top, won't it? And it will break, and it's not the worker's fault. It just happened to them. It was going to happen, and it happened to them. And I think that's a really important principle that we do defend. And I just want to talk about the experience we had building up to this strike, because we took a gamble. The trade union laws are a flipping minefield, as those of us that have organised strikes will appreciate. And so often in workplaces, you organise an indicative ballot just to see, can you get a proper ballot off the ground? Well, we didn't have the luxury of time to organise an indicative ballot, so we gulped and decided we're going to go for the official ballot, which is a risk, because if you get a low turnout or you don't get the right vote, then you've told the employer you're not organised, so they can go ahead and do what they want to do. And faced with that, and knowing that we're short on reps on the ground, I just looked at one of our lists of people who put their names down as contacts, as, you know, or just people I remember from who keep turning up to meetings, invited them to a meeting in the office. There was about six, seven of them, and I said, okay, this is the scale of the organisation we need. You, each of you has to be responsible for eight people. I'm going to give you the names, the addresses, the phone numbers, but in order to do this, you have to be a rep. Will you do it to do that? And they all signed up. They all signed up. They took their eight names. They did the ringing round. They've been speaking to people. And that helped us turn the vote out. And it has been, people who know me a bit more closely will know, it's been a real effort to keep it going because there are still big areas that we haven't reached. One of the big breakthroughs, though, that we've had, which was unfortunately the the activity of another trade union, unfortunately, the GMB bottled their ballot. Their reps were so disgusted, they all joined unison. But now, for the first time, we have got refuse workers refusing to go out with the rubbish. People understand are starting to understand really what's at stake. And we're organising catering workers as well. We need the private sector and the bakers union and all them to organise, because our employers, when they look at privatisation, that's what they aspire to. And we have to aspire to that level of organisation which prevents that from happening. And you know, and we need a better trade union movement. And can I just say one more thing? If you are in dispute on the day that the bill, the Parliament bill goes through, where they want to restrict trade unions, well, Barnet council workers and Bromley council workers are looking to identify that date so that we go out on strike together. So we have another 8th of July. And we're also thinking seriously about mobilising and organising a strike day for the TUC conference so that we call out our trade union leaders. If you have a dispute at that time, and in some ways I hope you don't have to have a dispute, but if you do, look at those dates. Can we all unify and match up and make it happen together?
Thank you. Hi, I'm Rosalind. This is my first time at Marxism and my first time speaking at all. I'm a member of the Bakers Union in Glasgow and worked with Lorna and Tony in the same job that we both talked about. Before moving on to my current job in a well-established and very busy independent restaurant. The restaurant was founded on socialist values in the 70s, with entry-level employees being paid more than the minimum wage at the time, being given proper training, and the division of labour being evenly spread. These values have been deteriorating, starting with our holiday pay being taken away each financial year if we were not able to take them. And I should say that our holiday time is given at the discretion of our management. So some full-time employees are not able to receive their, you know, accrued holiday pay by the end of the financial year. So, I've worked in this job for 2.5 years now, and I'm yet to sign a contract. My job security is basically non-existent. The company scrapped supervisor roles, and expect minimum wage workers to carry out tasks and undertake responsibilities that were not paid for. It feels as though the division of labour is not evenly spread anymore, and the physical demands required of minimum wage employees are being exploited. Those who are good at their jobs seem to be punished for it. I'm not paid to work 10-hour shifts on a human mezzanine level with a kitchen in the basement and only have a 20-minute break in between. I'm not paid to train new staff members when I feel disposable myself. On the 15th of April, the day of the fast food protests, I felt empowered by my fellow protesters as we were taking action to change the conditions of minimum wage and zero-hour contract workers to challenge the exploitative bosses. I have plans to unionise my own workplace, as Tony and Lorna have done, so we can begin to make real change as the fast food workers in America have. Thank you.
Thanks. Candy Edwin from the National Gallery, where we've just finished our 46th day of strike action against privatisation so that we hang on to the rights that we do still have and don't have what people have been talking about. And I think it's a really inspiring meeting to hear about the resistance that people have been putting up. I mean, I think the reason why we're still fighting, and actually we'll be voting next week on escalating our action further, is I think it's what Ian was talking about, is I think because we've combined strike action with direct action, with political campaigning, with the 50,000 people who've signed our petition. And I think that's a model that we all can follow and, you know, learn. We've learned that from other people, and I think that we can share some of that method. And it's the same method that people have been talking about this evening. It's actually not just young Greek people and young Spanish people who are political. There's a new mood in this country of resistance, of people going on protests, going on demonstrations, and they don't necessarily know about trade unions, about what they're for, what they do, what they can achieve. We've found people bumping into our strike and being inspired by it. And I think that's a task for us, is to go away and inspire people. And so then when we're providing the solidarity that makes sure that they're not left to fight on their own at Sotheby's, and that we stand together with them and make sure that they win, or the solidarity that we hope that you go on providing for our strike, that is something actually that we can use to teach people that. But as well as demonstrating, we believe that workers have got power to change things, and that's why we think trade union struggle is so important. So.
Hi, I'm Phil Turner from the Journalist Union. Oh, so you know, that's my story gone. What I wanted to say is I wanted to talk about two successful fightbacks in the NEJ, my union, in the last few months. In a union, really, that's found it hard to recover after derecognition in the 80s, and it's still really recovering from that period, really after whopping and defeats like that. But yes, I would like to start with the victory in my workplace, which was for me to save my job, and for the victimisation of me as a NUJ rep for more like 30 years. I've been there 32 years, and the redundancy was withdrawn and rescinded, and I'm still there. And that was a victory for solidarity, and I would like to thank everybody here that supported me, and in particular the Baker's Union, because Ian was one of the first to send a message to both our union and to our bosses. So thanks very much, Ian. And, you know, our chapel were only disappointed in as much as they didn't go on strike, because the company backed down before our strike went ahead. But, of course, they do know that it's the power that they had that actually forced the company, with that brilliant solidarity, to back away. And, in fact, we know that because our boss told us in a staff meeting last week, because he couldn't stop himself having a go, and he told us actually we cost him a lot of money, even though we called the strike off. So the message to my chapel members was, well, we're going to do this again. We're going to keep on fighting. We're going to keep on hurting them. And the other success is amongst the NewsQuest group, NEJ members there, took 10 days of strike action across South London and elsewhere around the country against more job losses and pay cuts and attacks on conditions. And they've actually, we've found out today, been successful. We're thinking winning a decent deal there on pay and jobs. So, you know, that shows the potential, I think, all the while, and particularly young workers, because in our chapel, those chapel members who were disappointed about not going on strike had never been on strike before. And that is, I think, what's beginning to break through, is where young workers are starting to give confidence to others to start fighting. Because you don't need that many in a workplace to stand up and say, well, let's have a go. And that gives confidence to other people. And then I think solidarity is so important, because it's a two-way street. When you raise money for another strike, like Candy's dispute at the National Gallery or anywhere else, actually that starts to give you confidence in your workplace to get organised and to start to fight back. And that's why it's vital. In our chapel, we've supported everyone, really, from the miners in 84 right through to the fight against racism in Rotherham over the child sex abuse scandal, where Nazis were coming into the town every week. You know, so that sort of work is really important. And that's why I think you can see that confidence is starting to come back, and those victories, we hope, will turn to more victories. And as far as I'm concerned, the message here tonight should be defend our unions, fight racism, fight austerity. If we fight, we can win.
Yeah, I just want to thank everybody who's spoken tonight at the meeting, because I think, you know, you listen to a lot of the, you know, the stories about the conditions that people are working in, the bullying management, how shit it is. But actually, every single one of those stories hasn't just been people getting up and talking about how shit it is. It's been people talking about things that they're doing to organise and fight back. So it's been incredible to listen to. And I think, you know, it tells you something about the nature of these jobs, because, yes, you know, people are in a very difficult position to put their heads above the parapet. But actually, you know, if I think I spent 6 years working in the catering industry, and if I think back to the experience of that, you know, one of the things that I remember from it was that there were little battles taking place all the time, like Tim described earlier on. I remember one time where, you know, the management were really pushing it to a point of just, you know, utterly taking the piss out of us, leaving us with the keys, not properly stocking the place, leaving us to deal with all these problems. And everybody just got so fucked off that they ended up going and sitting in the kitchen and refusing to work. And the whole, we essentially shut the restaurant early. But, you know, when we actually came back to try and unionise that, because of the kind of lack of a wider struggle and a wider confidence that people had, you know, it was difficult to sustain that, really. So, you know, I think people are constantly being put under pressure, and people are constantly having these little battles. So there's a huge potential to organise in new areas. And one of the things about the stories from America is that, you know, where the union has put resources into that fight, and the workers have just, it's taken off, and the workers have just kind of led it in such an incredible, inspiring way. I remember meeting a woman from Chicago called Jessica, who was a fast food worker, who talked about, you know, when the union came into the workplace, they didn't need to tell me that I hated all this stuff about my job and that I wanted to change it, but they gave me the confidence and the sense that we could come together collectively and do something about it. So I think, you know, the role that leadership can play is really important. And one of the things that the Bakers Union initiative of the Fast Food Rights Campaign has been so good at, really, it's not just about recruiting fast food workers into the Bakers Union. It's about actually, at a time of austerity, at a time where we really urgently need to see our unions fighting back and organised sections as well, a union that's fighting to say, actually, as a part of that wider battle, we need to be taking up the issues of 0 hours and of places that are unorganised and fighting to organise them as well. So I think we've got a big fight on our hands, really, and that's got to be about coming out of this meeting and making sure that we're linking up, you know, organised places that are fighting against, you know, victimisation and so on, fighting for our unions to call national action that can actually feed into a wider movement and win, but also as a part of that, link in with the workers that are organising in new areas as well.
I'm going to bring it back to our speakers to sum up. We haven't even got through a third of all the people that have wanted to speak. I'm really sorry about that, but we're short on time. So just maybe a minute to 2 minutes to sum up. Would you like to say something to sum up? You okay? Just if you want to come back on anything that came from the floor there. You can think about it. I'll get the bakers.
I'll just be brief. Something that I've picked up on tonight is that we have got fights and battles going on everywhere, and the key is to be organised. We need to be working together. So, for example, I had a guy come into my shop the other day that turns out he works for the prison office, the prison at Wakefield Prison, and he'd never heard of NAPO. And I was like, you need to be joining your union. For God's sake, don't be coming into Greggs and buying a £3 meal deal. Go sign up to your union and spend it on that. And that's what we need to be doing. We need to be coordinating with each other, not just fighting our own battles, but helping everybody else. So that's all I've got to say.
I'm really proud. I mean, the fast food rights campaign is an inspiration from America that's given certainly my trade union an opportunity to engage with people and to be inspired. Personally, my inspiration comes from people like Lorna and Tony, you know. And I think what we've seen in our trade union through being involved in the fast food rights campaign is that all this nonsense about young people not being interested in politics is utter garbage. Those young people are looking for leadership, and we failed and let them down. So it's about time we recognise that. About time we actually recognised and engaged. This idea that the living wage that they're talking about introducing will benefit anybody is absolute utter garbage too. Don't be conned. That announcement and that spin that came out in the budget was all about covering up the attacks and the decrease in people's income. It was nothing to do whatsoever with making people better off in this country. The £10 an hour campaign is absolutely a priority for every person in this country. We don't want devolution in Scotland that enables them to set a different rate. We want a national minimum wage for every single worker in this country of no less than £10 an hour, not in 2020, today. And we go out and we fight for it. We fight for it. And we don't want 0-hour contracts. We want them abolishing. We don't want them reforming, we want them getting rid of. And we want the end of inequality. If they think it's okay to discriminate against young people, we've got to say, young people, old people, in between people, whichever age group we're in, it's not acceptable. We don't accept it as discrimination. We're going to fight for our young people because that's what we have to do. Join together, stand together, fight together, win together.
Thank you. It's such a good inspirational meeting. Give us such a, motivation and to keep going and win the victory. I just want to remind you again, please come down on the 16th. We're all going to meet at 6 o'clock in Oxford Circus. Please come to support us. Solidarity with the cleaners and supporters at Sotheby's. Also, please sign our petition in change.org and also follow us in Facebook, uvwunion.org.uk. And also, please, if you want to make some donation we need for our campaign, we don't know how long it's going to take, but we are ready to fight. So please make your donation. I'm just going to pass to my work colleague. Thank you so much.
As my colleague said, it's a big inspiration for all of you guys. You know, that's the strength that it keeps us fighting. And as we say, we will win. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much. Thanks so much to all our speakers. And every contribution as well. I'm sorry we didn't get round everyone, but I would really like to invite the choir to the front. So I think that'd be a nice way to end this. So do we? Oh, there's loads of them. So do we still have Jarell? We do. Jarell, can you have to help us. So this is from the picket lines in North Carolina, and it's a call and response song. So that means you have to do it with us. But call and response. So I'll call it, and you guys have to respond and sing back to me. And the choir will kind of lead this off and help as well. We also adapted some of the lyrics so that, I hope you don't mind, Jarell, but... right. So, McDonald's, McDonald's, can't you see? What justice means to me.
What justice means to me.
McDonald's, McDonald's, can't you see?
McDonald's, McDonald's, can't you see?
What justice means to me.
What justice means to me.
Whoa.
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 An injury to one.
An injury to one.
Is an injury to all. Oh, Burger King, oh, Burger King.
Oh, Burger King, oh, Burger King.
Give me 15.
Give me 15.
Oh, Burger King, oh, Burger King.
Oh, Burger King, oh, Burger King.
We need 15.
We need 15.
Whoa.
Whoa. Whoa.
Seems they didn't hear the call.
An injury to one.
Is an injury to all.
Is an injury to all.
McDonald's, McDonald's, tell us when.
You're gonna give us 10.
McDonald's, McDonald's, tell us when.
You're gonna give us 10.
Whoa.
Whoa.
A victory 2-1.
Is a victory to all.